Random House Audio presents Star Wars, Clone Wars, Gambit, Stealth, by Karen Miller. Read for you by Jeff Gurner. Chapter 1. As far as Ahsoka Tano was concerned, the only thing worse than being up to her armpits in battle droids was waiting to find out just how long it would be before she was up to her armpits in battle droids. She hated waiting. But it seemed that war was all about waiting, at least when it wasn't about staring death in the face.
But I'm not scared. I'm not scared. I'm not scared. I'm not...
With Resolute out of rotation for a refit, she stood on the bridge of Indomitable, one of the next generation of cruisers to come out of the Alantine 6 shipyards. Cruisers that were faster and more responsive than ever before, thanks to her master's, what did the chief shipwright call it? Oh yes, tinkering. Thanks to Anakin's tinkering, the new vessels were a definite cut above the First Republic cruisers that had rolled out of production for service in this war against Dooku and his Separatist Alliance. The differences had been noted and were talked about whenever and wherever military types crossed paths. In battle, in briefings, sharing some chit-chat and a drink in this mess or that one, or even the occasional civilian bar. The Jedi who fought on the front lines were talking about them too. Everyone who relied on the massive Republic warships knew that their odds of survival had increased because Jedi Knight Anakin Skywalker liked to muck about with machines when he wasn't busy being the scourge of the Separatists. Anakin. That's how she thought of him now. After arduous months of fighting by his side, learning from him, saving him, and being saved by him. But she never called him that to his face. She couldn't. The idea of saying Anakin felt more disrespectful than a cheeky nickname. Sky Guy was familiar, but it wasn't intimate. First names were intimate. They implied equality. But she and her master weren't equals. She suspected they never would be. She was pretty sure that no matter how hard she trained, how hard she tried, even after she'd passed the trials and been made a Jedi Knight, she would never come close to matching him as a Jedi. How can I? He's the chosen one. He can do things that aren't meant to be possible. She snuck a sideways look at him, standing on the far side of Indomitable's bridge in hushed conversation with Master Kenobi and Admiral Yularen. Letting down her habitual guard the tiniest bit, she prepared to stretch out her senses, to feel what he was feeling behind his carefully constructed mask. It wasn't prying. She didn't pry. As a Padawan, it was her job, no, her duty, to make sure her master was well, to be constantly attuned to his mood so she could anticipate his needs and more perfectly serve him. Since joining Anakin on Christophsis, she'd lost count of the times that keeping a close eye on him had made the difference between success and failure, life and death. Young she might be, and still in training, but she could do that. She was good at that. Besides, once assigned to this man, she'd made her own private and personal vow quite apart from the public oaths she'd sworn in the Jedi Temple.
I will not be the Padawan who gets the Chosen One killed.
Around her, the bridge crew conducted its military business with brisk efficiency. No chatter since the Admiral was present. When Yularen was elsewhere, his officers sometimes indulged in a little gossip, a few jokes, a smattering of idle wartime speculation. Nothing detrimental to discipline, nothing untoward. Just harmless camaraderie to help while away the tedium of days like this one, when battle was yet to be joined, and the void beyond the trans-peristeel viewports remained empty of enemy ships and impending slaughter. She could hear, humming in the background, all the baffling hardware that made these warships possible. Sensor sweeps and multiphasic duo-diode relays and cognizant crystal interfaces and quasi-sentient droid links and stuff. So much stuff, and it made no sense to her. The slippery info laneways of computers she could work with, but she didn't possess any kind of knack for nuts and bolts and circuits machinery. Constructing her own lightsaber had nearly given her a nosebleed. Anakin, on the other hand, machinery was meat and drink to Anakin. He loved it. But she was letting herself become distracted, so she pushed those thoughts aside. Her immediate task was to ascertain what Anakin was feeling. That way, she'd have a better idea of what to expect from him when the news they were waiting for at last came through, and an idea of how best to deal with him once it did. Dealing with her master's sometimes overpowering emotions was becoming more and more a part of her duties. And as the war dragged on and their losses piled up, that job wasn't getting any easier.
He feels too much, too keenly. Maybe that's what happens when you've got the highest midichlorian count in Jedi history. Maybe that's the trade-off. You feel everything, so you're brilliant. You feel everything, and it hurts.
Not that his emotions got in the way. At least, he didn't think they did. And to be honest, she didn't either. At least, not as often as some people thought. Like Master Kenobi, for example, who chided his former Padawan for taking crazy risks, for pushing himself too hard, for letting things matter too much and losing his carefully measured Jedi distance. She didn't always disagree, and sometimes, when Anakin had given her a really bad fright or when his mood became difficult, she wished she could chide him too. But as a Padawan, she had to find another way to let her master know he'd gone too far. So she sassed him, or invented nicknames that were guaranteed to get under his skin. Sometimes she even deliberately flouted his wishes. Anything to break him free of sorrow or frustration or some bleak memory he refused to share. Anything to let him know, hey, what you did then? That was stupid. But mostly, she kept her fears for him to herself because all his bright and burning passion for justice, his reckless courage, his hunger for victory, and his refusal to accept defeat, they were what made him Anakin. He wouldn't be Anakin without his feelings. She knew that. She accepted that. No matter what temple teachings said about the Jedi and their emotions.
And even though he scolds, I think Master Kenobi accepts it too. He only scolds because he cares.
So, what was her brilliant, sometimes volatile master feeling now? Eyes drifted half-closed, Ahsoka breathed out a soft sigh and let her growing Jedi awareness touch lightly upon him.
Impatience, concern, relief, loneliness, weariness, and grief not yet healed.
Such a muddle of emotions, such a weight on his shoulders. Months of brutal battle had left her drained and nearly numb, but it was worse for Anakin. He was a Jedi general with countless lives entrusted to his care, and every life damaged or lost he counted as a personal failure. For other people, he found forgiveness. For himself, there was none. For himself, there was only anger at not meeting his own exacting standards. Feeling helpless, she chewed at her lip. She didn't know what she could do to make anything better for him. She couldn't heal his grief for the clones who'd fallen under his command or the civilians he'd been unable to save. She couldn't make him less tired or order him home to Coruscant where his mood always lightened. She couldn't promise the war would end soon with the Republic victorious. At least he had Master Kenobi's company for a little while. She was sure that accounted for his relief. They cheered each other up, those two. No matter how dire the straits, Anakin and Master Kenobi always managed to find a joke, a laugh, some way to ease the tension and pressure of the moment. Between the two men lay absolute trust, absolute faith. Now they were equals. On the outside, looking in, she couldn't help feeling a little forlorn.
Will he ever feel that way about me? Will he ever believe in me the way he believes in Obi-Wan?
She opened her eyes to find Anakin looking at her. Though she'd tried so hard to be discreet, still he'd felt her sensing of him. She held her breath, expecting a reprimand. Anakin hated when she did this. But no reprimand came. Instead, her master raised a tolerantly amused eyebrow at her. And in his eyes was a kind of tired appreciation. She felt herself shrug, a tiny twitch of one shoulder, and curved her lips into a small, rueful, I can't help it, smile. He took a breath. He was going to say something, but then his head lifted. So did Master Kenobi's. A few moments later, she felt it too. A sharp, almost painful tingle of awareness. Something was coming.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.